Let's lift our hands this morning. Let's send that fire again if we can, Emily. Come on, there's a new fresh spirit today that wants to bring you peace. How many of you know that Christ is alive? That prayer can change a city. Prayer can move mountains. We're not the tail, we're the head. Amen? We shall walk with what? Endurance. With the power of God. The blood of Christ that set us free. That blood speaks of better things of you today. You never have to carry oppression in this place. However you've come this morning, we release and declare that God's Spirit will break the yoke of oppression. Amen?
Amen.
Let's send fire again. Come on, our worship leader. Lift these hands. Who cares if we can't sing? We can declare. Sukubashi kididi baka. Fire. Yes, Lord. Where the Spirit of God is, there's what? What is there? Liberty, freedom, healing, salvation. He who wins souls is lost. We've come to win the lost at all cost. No matter what it takes, we will preach the gospel of the resurrection of Christ. And Father, we come in your house this morning to receive with an expectant heart, with faith, declaring that whatever we're hindered today, by faith I'm walking in my healing. Amen. You may be seated. We welcome you this morning.
Welcome, everybody. I was just thinking today about the 31st of October that it is today. People say that's Halloween. It's not Halloween. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. This is God's day. Hallelujah. This is Jesus' day. We won't accept that this is a devil's day. No way. All right. Amen.
Thank you, my beautiful wife. Always busy with the kids and work. Welcome, everyone. Thank you, Emily. Beautiful. Thank you so much, children. We are going to our little room at the back. Welcome, live streamers, as always. Good to see everyone this morning. Wasn't that nice? I don't know about you, but when I was singing that, I felt God's presence. Amen. When we declare, come on, when we call on God, He brings the power in our life. John 14, Jesus said, I come to give you peace. Colossians says that we need to receive the peace. Amen? So we're going to go to a time, this is a communion service. We do this, I hope we do it twice a month. I think we're losing it a bit there. I think it's once a month, but supposed to be first week and last week of the month. Our wonderful Geeth is going to come and share communion. Steve at the back is going to hand the communion out with you. And we're just going to go to a time of communion. Come up, my dear beloved. Let's welcome Geetha.
Thank you, Geetha.
That's all right.
There you go. I always felt before going into a communion, it's more of a personal reflection. So I was going through the Bible to find out the right words to share with you guys today. So I found this one, which was quite interesting. So the Lord's Supper is a reminder of what Jesus did in the past, a symbol of our present relationship with him, and a promise of what he will do in the future. So we're going to, it's not like a one-time ceremonial ritual, but it's more of, it's kind of related to the past, the present, and the future, which was quite interesting for me. So I was just going through it. So in the past, as we all know, the ancient Israelites looked back into the Passover events when they were delivered out of Egypt. So the Israelites always celebrated this as a sign of deliverance from Egypt. So how we can relate to ourselves is more like delivering ourselves from the clutches of the sin, which is related to the past. So when it comes to the present relationship to the Jesus Christ, the crucifixion, Christianity is nothing without meditating on the cross and the crucifixion. So with the present days, so when it comes to the present, it's like inviting a guest into our house. People who have kids know when we are expecting a guest, we stuff everything in a closet just to make everything look good. And just imagine the guest comes and opens the closet. You don't want that to happen. So that's exactly is what we do every day. So it's about inviting Christ in our life and then asking him, all right, God, you stay in the hallway. I'm fine there. You can come to kitchen. I'm fine. But then you don't want Jesus to open that closet. But so when it comes to communion, it's more of giving that opening up ourselves to each and every room in our heart. And finally, where Jesus goes into our closet and cleans everything. So it's like a day in and day out process. So this is how we relate to the communion with the present days. And going to the future, so the Lord's Supper has got rich meaning in it. So it's into the future. It's been a commandment for us to follow it until the return of God. So as Christians, we believe that Jesus is going to show up any moment. Are we ready to see him with the holy eyes? Are we ready to meet him? So the part of communion, it's so it's more of preparing us to meet God in the second coming. All right. So you got the cups? All right. So we're going to take a minute to bow down and look into our life. Take a minute. You don't have to repeat the prayer, but you can say it in your heart as you do this. It's more of introspecting into your heart and see where we stand in front of God, right? All right, so let's bow down and take a minute to look into our life. Lord Jesus, I bow before you in humility and ask you to examine my heart today. Show me anything that is not pleasing to you. Reveal any secret pride, any unconfessed sin, any rebellion or unforgiveness that may be hindering my relationship with you. I know that I'm your beloved child, having received you into my heart and life and having accepted your death as penalty for my sinfulness. The price you paid covered me for all time and my desire to live it for you. Take a minute and just meditate on that in your heart. So you can have the bread now. As I take this bread representing your life that was broken for me, I remember and celebrate your faithfulness to me and to all who will receive you. And in the same way, as I take this cup representing your blood poured out from a splintered cross, I realize that you were the supreme sacrifice for all my sins. You can have the cup. So once you're done, we've got to do a prayer as well. So let's bow down, and it's more of surrendering our life to God again. So each time I take communion, Lord, I want to recommit my life, my heart, my thoughts, my everything to you. Fill me today with your powerful spirit as I leave this place. Help me to hold this fresh remembrance and the story that never grows old close to my heart. Help me to share this message faithfully as you give the opportunity. In your precious name, amen.
Tumaha amanimbi. Matinda wundi ehwe ana artha. Kosta. Haya. Laite ina shalaba lehin piati. Kabilule. Wa okulu. Tinau kishmi. Il komi hiv. Bilo, steu, dyna dy mi, dy breith a chadatha, dy hifle com wachro bim, dy mas le chada un. Bwdw dyna le dy grani.
You know, they only brought three charges against him to crucify. One, they said, this man loves sinners. The second, he healed on the Sabbath day. And the third, he claimed to be the Son of God. Did ever a man die like Jesus? They first took long leather thongs with steel pellets or lead pellets on the end and beat him across the back until he could hardly stand up. Then they put a crown of thorns on his brow and his face was bleeding. And he dragged and lifted and hauled that cross. And then, on the cross, he said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And then he dropped his head and said, it's finished. Yes, they laid him away in a tomb. And when they went out to the tomb that morning, they heard the greatest news the world has ever known. He is not here. He is risen. He's alive. He is not here. Death could not hold him. He has conquered the grave. That's the greatest news the world has ever heard. He's a living Savior. He's alive. Thank you.
know how I can talk after that. Father, we exalt you this morning. We thank you for the resurrection. We thank you for the blood. That blood that spilled to the ground. The earth had never heard that voice before, because all it's heard is murder and iniquity. But that voice from the blood says you never have to struggle again. You never have to feel separated from God. You never have to carry sickness and oppression in your life, because his blood was spilt for you, and it spoke audibly to the God, his Father, your Lord, and said you never have to carry anything in your life. Today he can free you. So Father, we thank you for your word. Amen. Very hard to speak after that, because it was quite touching, wasn't it? I'm just going to move this forward a bit. Sorry. My dad did make it out of solid timber, I think. When Mike was here, I said, that thing's strong. So welcome, everyone. Lovely to see you. I just want to move this quickly. I don't want to move it too fast because there's oil in the back here. Okay, there we go. Can we have the lights on the back there? That'll be great, so I can see all of you. Amen. So we're going to go to a time of tithes and giving. We thank you for all your generosity and kindness to God. The tithes and the giving is what helps us fulfill God's purpose in this great nation of Australia. And our beloved Catherine's going to be put on the spot. You're going to come and pray for us, dear. And Catherine's going to come and pray for the offering for us this morning. Thank you, my lovely.
Thank you. Dear Heavenly Father, as we come to your presence this morning, we come with grateful hearts. And I too am a little bit emotional after just what I've just seen, and just such a beautiful communion that we all partook of. So Lord God, we give you thanks today. For as Beck said, this is the day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. And Lord, today as we take up the offering, Lord, this is an offering to you. It's not to anything other than to you, Lord God. And we just pray that you will bless those that have given this morning, and those that are unable to, Lord, a blessing to them also, Lord. We thank you and honour you in this house today, Lord God. And we just pray that as the offering is received, Lord God, that it'll be used for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Oh, yeah. Come on. You know where we're at. Tell me what you see. What's going on? Come on.
Everyone, those who've given today, we really speak the favor over your life. We're going to come to the time of teaching this morning. And firstly, I want to thank everyone who's been helping. All the volunteers, my wife, Beck, Janine, Emily, Dad, and a few others, Catherine, Geetha, everyone, if I've missed everyone, Maria, for bringing cookies every week. We want to thank you for it. This lady brings them without even asking. She just brings them. So please be sure to thank her for that. It really is a blessing to us, and we really honor you for doing that, and thank you. So we thank everyone. If I've missed anyone, come and hit me after the sermon. I'm okay. I can take it. It's all right. So we want to thank everyone. We really appreciate you, and everyone who's also contributed to when we decided to build this place. It was a huge, huge step of faith. I mean, we may not look at it and think this is a huge place, but it's a step. And it's a step where God wants us to be positioned in Tweed. How many of you know that Tweed needs a move of God? Our families need a move of God. Amen? And we need the truth preached. So we come into a time now where I just quickly want to give you quick announcements. We don't like to do it because our goal and desire or call is always to have 50% of this meeting for people to get free. So if you need to know what's happening at the back, there's information. You can speak to us. We have Zoom prayer. We're starting a life group every second week. So there's a few things that we're doing. If you need to know, jump on our website. So we don't want to take up time by saying this. So please talk to one of us. So we're going to go to a time we all know that. Did you know that the 800 horsemen on the 31st of October, on the day of Halloween, went in with 800 horses to rescue? Did you know that? This day, we should be celebrating the 800 horsemen for what they did in God's day. So this morning, this month was the month of Halloween, and I've preached on witchcraft as much as I can through this month to teach us and to come against it. And I've preached sermons to come against the powers of darkness. And I think it was last week, was it last week or the week before, I designed renunciation prayers, and we were all part of that as we came against the forces of darkness. And I believe that as a church, as a preacher, as Christians, we need to confront the forces of darkness to have a change in our nation and city. It's when the pulpit is quiet and does not address these matters, the enemy takes advantage. And so we're going to take you to Hosea 4:6, and I'll open with this, but I'm teaching today on the origins of Halloween, how it started, where it came from, and how we as Christians can pray during this time. There's many pagan holidays. There's many pagan holidays, but I wanted to touch on this one because it's a significant one. And we know that when it's Christ's death and resurrection, it's Passover week. I don't call it Easter. I call it Passover week. Okay? So just to clarify that. So quickly, let's go to Hosea 4:6. We all know the scripture. I think we do, but I'll remind you again. Very important for us to know. Hosea chapter 4 verse 6 says, "My people are destroyed for the lack of knowledge. Because you have rejected knowledge, I will also reject you from being priest for me. Because you have forgotten the law of your God, I will also forget your children." So let's just pray this morning. Father, we pray over the word today that we would understand what is taught today, that we would leave this place not only changed but set free. And Father, whatever doctrines we've been under through our lives as Christians, we pray that today, whatever doctrine has caused deception in our walk of God, that it'll be broken today, and that we would know what the true gospel of Christ is so that we can walk out in freedom. Amen. And so, as Christians, which I've noticed, dealing with people coming to me for many years for freedom, I've noticed one thing, two things. One Christian whose faith and belief is sound on a doctrine that is strong and unmovable. And they really position themselves in the Word of God. They don't change. And then I've seen a second Christian that changes their doctrine, and they go from church, to teacher, to prophet, to evangelist, to fire meeting, to meeting, and nothing changes. But the Christian that has a firm foundation in God, they get free. Because faith means that wherever you are, He will heal you. I don't need to chase a traveling preacher or prophet. I'm not against them. I'm talking about having a foundation in your life that nothing shifts you. So if it's this church or another church, find a Bible, biblical, strong doctrine church and ground yourself in there. Ground, get grounded. If it's this church or another, I'm not doing this to get people. I'm doing it for you. Find a place, stay there, and grow your faith. Amen? Because whatever's at the head, I've said this many times, whatever's at the top comes down onto the people. So whatever the top believes and has the spiritual gift comes onto the people. So if you would submit to that authority, whatever anointings on that church will come onto your life. But if you jump from place to place to place, you have no roots. You can't grow. So you eat in yeah and eat in yeah and eat in yeah. All foods are good, but you need to be grounded. So I've read that scripture for us to understand that people perish through the lack of knowledge. And Satan doesn't want you to have a strong foundation. He doesn't want you to be in a church that is spirit-filled and preaching the truth. He doesn't want you to have strong faith because he knows you're dangerous. You are very dangerous when you're on fire for God. When I came out of drugs, came out of the life, and I joined the church that my mother was, I never left that place. I stayed there, I studied, and then I came to this country and I grew. And it was a church of faith. It preached faith. That's all it did. It preached the power of faith. And we all developed a strong foundation. My grandfather that preached 40 years, all those members today, there's still some alive, 80, are still very strong in their faith because they're sat under a strong biblical teaching. So we need a strong foundation. Can you agree with that? When things don't go right, we think, let me go here, let me go there, let me try this. If you would stay, I promise you, you'll see the breakthrough. So I wanted to teach this morning on the origins of Halloween. Why am I doing this? You say, Pastor, why do you talk on this rubbish? Why do you preach on witchcraft? And so this is the month I've been hammering this subject for a while. But after this, we're going to preach differently. But I wanted to hammer this subject this month to give us teaching. Because many Christians don't understand. Many Christians let their children participate in these celebrations and think it's fun and good and don't understand the origins of where it came. Some of you might see the skulls and ghosts and goblins and things of death and think that's strange, but we don't know what's behind it. So we're going to teach on what's behind, what is the spirit behind it. Amen? Two things. God is omnipresent and omnipotent. Is that right? I got it, yes. I actually got it. Hallelujah. God is everywhere at one place and he is all powerful. Satan is a created being with limited resource and power. There's a difference. Satan has demons everywhere that are his eyes, but he's limited. So what does he do? He focuses his energy on certain dates of the calendar to enforce the powers of darkness at that particular time. So he can't have a resource like God because God's everywhere and all powerful, but he's limited. And so that's why you see a day like this, the 31st, that is very pushed quite heavily. It's in the shops, it's everywhere, because he has to focus at that time. And so as a Christian family, I would suggest that you would pray tonight as a family and pray protection over yourselves. So Satan has to direct his focus on certain events in time. And Halloween is one of these dates where the occult is increased. A lot of demonic activity at this time. Witches, Satanists, pagans, Wiccans, and all the demonic is very active at this time. All your Wiccans, pagans, Satanists at this time do their most hideous ceremonies. But we, as the church, are going to pray today that it won't affect us. And it doesn't affect us. We're covered by the blood. But it's affecting our culture. It's affecting our children. And we need to talk about it. Is that okay? A little bit of history for you. Halloween goes back to the Celtic calendar, who were pagans, which is the Druids. So this was called Samhain. It goes back to the Celtic calendar roughly 2,000 years ago. That's okay, it's just a bit of wind. When the Roman Empire of Constantine came into power, he gave a lot of authority to the church at that time because it was under persecution. And because of him, the church was released in a way from persecution. And he combined this fellowship with All Saints Day. Okay, so All Saints Day was to celebrate the saints that had passed. And so he commemorated this date when he defeated the territories of the heathens. He combined the day, the night of Samhain, with the day of All Saints Day. So it was a way of converting them in a way to Christianity by linking it some way, which a lot of us don't agree, but that's the history. So All Saints Day was the next day after Halloween. Huh? Yeah. Or Hallow Eve, that's it. So I can go into all that, but I'm just giving you a quick thumbnail. Samhain is the one of four major witches' sabbats. It's one of the, there's eight, but this is the fourth quite significant one. The first one is Imbolc, known as Honored Bridget, the pagan goddess of healing. That's in February 2. The second holiday was in May called Beltane. They worshipped the god of light and fire, and witchcraft times would plant, and druids would perform magical rites to encourage crop growth. The third massive day was August. It was a harvest festival in honor of the sun god, commemorated the shining one, Lu. You can also say that maybe it could be the Egyptian god, sun god, but that's a different story. And the third, these first three marks the passing of seasons, a time to plant, a time to harvest, a time for birth and rebirth, okay? And harvest, time for death and to rebirth. And so Samhain came as the fourth one, which is the start of winter, the end of summer. And this is when they would worship this Samhain, Lord, the God of the dead, which is aka Lucifer, which some of you might know, but through deliverance, we've encountered this, that it's actually the spirit of Lucifer. So Satan has direct his focus in certain times. Let me just get my papers. Is that okay? So I'm just teaching you a little bit of the history. Is that okay? So Samhain was the name for Halloween. That was the name according to the occultists, and it marked the coming of winter. So Samhain was the Lord of the Dead, which I said, which is Lucifer. And the Druids would worship this god through human sacrifice as they worship the Lord of the Dead. So Samhain is what you call Halloween today. This was the original name. So Halloween is it's a satanic day. Today is a satanic day, but this day is the Lord's day. It's not the devil's day. Amen? But I'm teaching you three things. Worship of the dead. Number two, celebrates evil. Number three, embraces fear. That's what's behind this. I went to the shop to buy some stuff. I'll show you. So you could see. So you can buy your little kid a witchcraft. That's for what? A two-year-old, three-year-old, four-year-old Alice band? So you can let her wear that. That's at the shop. Then we have devil ears. It actually says devil. And you can put that on your little two-year-old because it can only fit a two-year-old's head. So these are the symbols that are sold in our shops to promote the things of the devil and the things of fear. That's to promote fear. And so you let your kid wear that. A lot of us do, don't we? Hopefully not Christians. The second thing is, don't worry, I'm going to throw all this away. These are Halloween gummy body parts that you can give your kids. So all different body parts, hearts, eyeballs, brains, intestines. And let me tell you, this is normal to the demonic because when they sacrifice, they do these things. So you can buy your beautiful little two-year-old a nice little lolly that could be cursed. Amen? So I'm showing you some illustrations. Is that okay? So I went to the shop yesterday to buy this stuff, and there was a whole section. And I was horrified when I saw the stuff. And one of the dolls would talk in a death-looking face. Anyway, we'll show you images. But this lady said to me, "I can't believe what's happened. Our children like this." I said, "Ma'am, I'm sorry to say it's not our kids. It's us that have allowed it." She didn't answer me. So she was blaming the children. And I quickly said, "It's not the kids. We have allowed this culture in our nation by not coming against it." Am I right? One Sunday, I took my kid to the shop and she started to get scared. "Oh, Daddy, help me." I said, "Why?" There was a little witch on the side. Scary, horrible looking thing. And so we went there and I told her, "Let's hit it on the head." And you're defeated. So this is what's in this time of year. It promotes the worship of dead. Because in the ancient times, they would sacrifice for the dead and worship the dead ancestors. So have you seen this in the shops? I think it's taken up a notch. I don't remember seeing this quite heavily dead-looking skulls in the shops. And you can get your kid to wear an outfit of Jason with a knife, the serial killer. So I was at the playground yesterday and I was talking to the kids. I said, "Do all of you believe in Halloween?" And they said, "Yes." I said, "Why? It's fun." I said, "But isn't it not nice to wear skulls? Don't you get nightmares?" And then some of them said, "Actually, yes, we do." So I said, "Well, why do you want to wear it?" And one girl said, I want to dress up as a serial killer. I said, no ways. Why do you want to be a serial killer? Can you see what's happening? So their first response is, it's fun. And then when I said, but do you know what a serial killer is? He kills people. Oh. And I said, do you want to be a vampire that drinks blood? Oh, that doesn't sound nice. I said, there we go. And I was talking to them at my sister's complex. Can you imagine your child running down the street with Jason the serial killer? Huh? I mean, this is what's happening. So we've got to talk about it, amen? So if you're a Christian, you've got to teach your kids the real meaning of this. I just wanted to do this because I've never done it before. I've never preached much on this and probably shouldn't preach a whole sermon on it, but I wanted to just give you a thumbnail of what's behind it. Is that okay? Just get a little bit organized here. Lovely to see all of you. Always nice. It was so wonderful. You must remember that Samhain, this time of year, marked a time when the boundary to the other world was thinned. What do I mean? They believed that it allowed the souls of the dead people to visit their families. Spirits at this time could also travel. So this time of year was a time that these occultists believed that the atmosphere was thinned and there was a communication with the other world. And I'm going to teach on why and we do certain things in Halloween. So it was a night that Samhain would return with the spirits of the dead and they had to be treated or the living would trick them. Trick, treat came from this ancient belief that they had to treat the dead spirits, otherwise they would be tricked. And so that's where we get the trick, treat. We have to treat the evil spirits so they don't trick us. And so we send our kids there to trick and treat because it's fun. But we don't realize this was an occultic origin to appease these demons. Amen? And so they would set huge bonfires back in this time to frighten the evil spirits. In the 19th century, I'm giving you history, the Irish introduced Halloween into the USA, the Irish. See, this predominantly came from the Celtics and the Irish, the Druids, because they were one of the most original Wiccans back in that time. I've just lost my page. Okay, here we go. Oh, there it is. So Halloween was a time, now when it came into America in the 19th century, listen to this, very interesting. Halloween was a time of consent to damage property if they weren't treated. People would vandalize properties, they would unloose barn doors so all the cows would go and the horses would go. They would loosen steps of people's homes so they'd fall and break a leg. And they would damage property at this time. Letterbox would be blown up if you didn't treat the people. And this was allowed. It was the one time in the whole year that this was condoned. And so eventually a man decided to bring out the costumes and sales, and this just took off. This man made millions, and it became into what we have now, the costumes, the masks, and everything that we have. So I'm going to touch on what these actual masks and all this means. So is this okay? I hope I'm doing okay. I'm trying my best to give you a thumbnail. I'm just giving you a thumbnail. I can't do it all because it takes too long. What is the Halloween ties with the occult today? What is it tying us? What are we, when we see the mask, the outfits, what is it tying to the occult? First one, costumes from the occultic Druid idea that ceremonial participants could wear animal heads and animal skins to acquire the strength of the beast that they portrayed. This, my friend, is a satanic individualism belief that we are beasts. We're not human, but we are beast. And we can become a wolf or a beast because we have animalistic instinct. This is an ancient belief of Satanism that you get to decide what you want because you're an animal. So if I murder, if I steal, if I lie, it doesn't matter because you acted on your expression. And animalistic because they don't believe that we are human, but we have an animistic side to our life. So if you desire lust, you must do it as much as you can to get out of it. If you decide to do these things, they believe you must do it as much as you can so you don't hunger it anymore. But Jesus says different. You need to get free of that because it brings bondage. See how it's the opposite? Number two, trick and treat is Irish tradition led. This was led a procession to levy contributions from farmers lest their crops be cursed. Number four, drinking for apples. Old practice of divining the future. Participants who successfully clenched an apple with their feet could count on a fulfilling romance with the lover of their choice. This, my friend, is one of the ancient divinations. And we all know that Christ is the only one that knows the future. So this bobbing for apples was part of this belief. And so you see this at this time. I've seen it on YouTube, or families have told me they put a bucket with apples. Oh, it's fun. We see which kid can get the apple. It's an ancient practice. Number four, cats represent incarnated humans, spirits, or familiar spirits of witches. How many of you know that a black cat is used in the occult to pick up familiar spirits? It's used to pick up the things of the demonic. That's why the black cat is always with an occultist, because they use that cat to pick up demons and other presences of witches. So it's used as a familiar spirit. Number four, masks have traditionally been an animistic means of superstitiously warding off evil spirits or changing the personality of the wearer to communicate with the world. We don't need to do that to communicate. You come as you are. You come as you are. Jesus accepts you for who you are. You don't have to be someone you're not. And this is the whole thing behind the masks. It's to scare the spirits away. So when they see you, they hide. And so we're giving this to our kids. The last one, jack-o'-lanterns. How many of you knows the jack-o'-lanterns? The pumpkin that's carved out with the light, the face. This comes from the late tale of the notorious man named Jack, who was turned away from heaven and hell, consigned to roam the earth as a spirit. Jack put a glowing coal into a carved out turnip to light his way through the night. This became a pumpkin symbolizing a damned soul. This is the pumpkin that your kids carve out and put lights in. It represents Jack, this notorious story of this evil, wicked man. See? It's not cute, is it? We're going to take you to some slides now, and Janine's going to show us a few slides just to show you what happens at this time, which I took pictures at shops. She's going to help us. Samhain is a time to remember our dead, but not to mourn them, rather to embrace their spirits and let their wisdom help guide us in our time here on earth. My goodness me, that's blasphemy. Next slide. This is the pumpkin. That's jack-o'-lanterns. And the next one. How do you like that? You like that one? That's teaching your kids that we must go sacrifice Toby. But it looks fun, doesn't it? Next slide. That's nice, isn't it? Death. I mean, look at the skulls on the left. Would you want your kid to take that home? And that's the doll that I saw in the shop that when you turned it on, it said, "Help me, Jason's coming." So that's, you can give that to your two-year-old. And now we dress our kids up to go out on this night. And the next slide. Isn't that cute? We dress them up as dead people and to tell them it looks cute. I'm exposing this power that's beyond Halloween. If you're a Christian today, please, you need to teach your kids what this means. When you look at that, you realize it's not cute. But you see, they make it look fun to the children. I want to expose this today because it's behind the principalities affecting our churches and towns, and we need to be a church that rises above it. Do you believe it? Amen. Today I printed out 10 sheets of the 9 statements of Halloween that I counteracted with Scripture, and I'm going to read them to you. And I gave it to all the parents. Your kids have it. They're going to give it to you when they come home, and they can understand what it is. So this will help them. These are the 9 statements that Halloween, which I call, are the 9 hoax of Halloween. The first one is death is to be feared. We see symbols of death and fear everywhere. Imagery of demons, skullheads, scorps, skeleton spiders, witches, ghosts, and evil masks. There's a spirit of death and fear that's behind Halloween. But I tell you now that in 1 Corinthians 15:55, Jesus mocks death by says, "Oh death, where is your sting and where is your victory? For he has conquered the death and risen up." Jesus Christ rose from the dead and he conquered death. So that's the first hope. You don't have to fear death because Jesus Christ conquered it. Amen. The second one, the second hoax that I say that they say, The dead can return as ghosts. Ghosts are demons lying and deceiving the living who are grieving the loss of their loved ones. If you have a loved one that's died today and you try and seek them, you cannot find them. You're going to see it's a demon that looks like them and talks like them. Necromancy. The dead can't come back because in Hebrews 9:27 it says it's appointed by one man to die and then the judgment. And Ecclesiastes 12:7 says the dust will return to the earth and the spirit will turn to God, which is his. You cannot communicate with the dead. That's the second hoax of Halloween. It's deceptiveness. How sad that when your lost one has died and you go and contact the dead and you've been deceived. Amen. Number three, the devil or a witch can tell the future. This is what Halloween promotes. The ancient practice of divination, of bobbing for apples to try to tell the future, that's what it tries to do. The devil can't tell the future. Do you know why? My Bible says in Revelation 1:8, Jesus is the Alpha, the Omega. He's the beginning and the end. He knows from the beginning to the end. He is the only one that can tell the future. Amen? They can't. It's a curse that comes into your life. Jesus, you are the only one that knows my life. Amen? So don't go listen to people who try and talk about your future, because when they speak it, it's a curse. I ministered to a lady who was in the New Age. I ministered to a lot of them. And this particular one said, Pastor, but they said everything that came to pass. I said, what did they say? Said, I was going to go through marital problems. So I said, she cursed you. But it came to pass. I said, yes, because you came in agreement with that word. And when you came into agreement with it, the devil said, ha, I've got agreement now and a legal right. I'll make sure it comes to pass. So they can't tell the future. They can only speak of the past, the present, but the future is a curse. Is this okay? I know I'm preaching. I hope not everyone's uneasy with this. I just want to expose this. Come on, you know my heart. Amen. You know my heart. Number four, the fourth hoax of Halloween is the powers of darkness must be respected and appeased. Give me a break. Give me a break. This is what trick and treating is all about. By treating the spirits that came back from the dead in Halloween, or they will trick you. Well, my Bible says in 1 John 3:8, Jesus came to destroy the works of the devil. I don't need to appease them or fear them. Jesus came to destroy the work of the enemy. This is what Wiccans believe. I'm getting excited. Number five, witches and pagans are loving, peaceful Wiccans. Well, I want to tell you now, they are cultists in league with Satan, promoting self-individualism and bringing curses on our nations. They're not so peaceful and kind as what you think they are. And the ones that I've ministered to are quite broken, are quite hurt, are quite angry, are quite upset, because a lot of them have get into this because they've come from an upbringing where their parents have hurt them. And it's a source of power for them. We have to love them. We can't judge them because they need to come to the love of God. I've seen a lot of these people. They hurt, they're broken. You know, Marilyn Manson came out of a Christian home. What happened? A lot of these people, they come out of a Christian home. Number six, extreme evil can keep you from heaven. This is the sixth hoax of Halloween. Where does this come from? That's where the story of jack-o'-lanterns came from. It said that a legend that a man called Jack was so evil he couldn't get into heaven and the devil didn't want him in hell. So he carved out a turnip and put a candle in it to govern him through this world. Now we carve this in a pumpkin. But I'm here to tell you in Hebrews 7:25, God is able to save the uttermost. No one is too bad or too evil that can't get to heaven. It doesn't matter what you've done today. Jesus can save you. It doesn't matter how evil you are. Christ can forgive you and you can go to heaven. So that, my friend, is the sixth hoax of Halloween, that you are too evil to be saved. I'm here to tell you that Jesus Christ came to save everyone. Number seven, it's okay to glorify fear in fun. As I've said, what does Hebrews 11:6 say? Without faith, it is impossible to please Him. Fear is the enemy of faith. 2 Timothy 1:7, we have not been given a spirit of fear. We should not embrace fear and try to have peace with fear. Jesus gives peace. So when we make it look fun and we embrace fear as a fun, cute thing, we're accepting that in our children's life. That's the seventh hoax of Halloween. Number eight, Halloween is a day to be worshipped and celebrated. What a hoax. As Christians, we must not compromise. Hello? How do you compromise? By embracing this image of evil and legitimizing this day. 2 Corinthians 6:17, God says, come out and be separate and do not touch what is evil. Number nine, the last one. Halloween is a day to be feared. That's another hoax. It's not to be feared at all. There are certain days the devil has on his calendar, but my Bible says in Psalms 118, this is the day and I'll be glad in it and I'll rejoice. Amen? This day, every day, I'll rejoice in God Almighty. So that's the ninth hoax of the devil. Did you enjoy that? I gave it to all our kids. Go pin it on your fridge and show them this so you can have it if you want. The next one I'm going to do before we minister, because we're going to go quickly, is the three influences of Halloween. Three. Number one, desensitizing our children to what is actually evil. That's the goal. To desensitize your kids. You know, I saw a pacifier with ghosts on the pacifier. So you can give your child a ghost. So we desensitize in our children by saying that that's cute. Desensitizing them. And I know of a little girl of 15 or 16, which we know, that practices witchcraft because they've seen it's fun. So by desensitizing, when evil is made to look fun and innocent, this is how it traps them when the kid is going through a tough time in life, 16, 17. That's where they get trapped because they think it's innocent. When our kids grow up in a culture that is bent on evil, when we permit symbols of death and darkness to control our culture, our children grow up with no acknowledgement of its demonic and evil origins. Because we permit it. Number two, minimizing the devil's devices. All areas of the occult are rampant at this time. Very scary, minimizing the devil's devices. Means you minimize the things of the devil. When we don't avoid all aspects of evil, as Paul states in the book of Thessalonians, we give power to the occult. When you minimize the devices, when that little red devil horn is made in a cartoon, we minimize in the things of the devil. All forms of the occult, Ouija boards, astrology, divination, tarot cards, all lead to demonic torment. Hello? I've dealt with this many times. These things lead to demonic torment. Our kids need to understand this. So every aspect of the occult must be completely avoided and never considered harmless and fun. Number three, and I'm going to close very soon. Legitimizing the agents of Satan. Displaying evil masks, ghosts, evil dolls, and black cats endorses demon spirits. When you invite these things in your home, this stuff, you're inviting the presence of evil in your home. And that child said to me yesterday, yes, I get nightmares, and I wonder why. Because maybe last year she brought all this stuff and dressed up in the stuff, and the devil had a legal right. Amen? So wearing a cartoon with devil horns, what it does, it reduces Satan's evil debauchery. It reduces his debauchery. Listen to this statement that I read, which is very important, which I wrote, sorry. The true evil is not what the devil can do, but what we allow him to do by embracing the culture of Halloween. Did you understand that? There's no power in an idol. There's power in what you believe it to do. They're dead. Amen? So, Father, we thank you today for who you are, that we expose the unfruitful works of darkness. And as we go to Ephesians, are you okay? Is anyone feeling agitated? I'll pray for you. Because maybe it's stirring some stuff up. And that's the purpose of this, to come against these things. Amen? What does the Bible say in Ephesians 5:11? It says, and have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather expose them. Are we living separate from the world? I'm talking to you now. Are you living separate from the world? Are you, as a Christian family, living for Christ and not allowing the things of this world to come into your precious home? Are we putting God first in our lives? Are you putting Him first in your business and in your family? It's something that I learned in our company. We used to drive it ourselves. And I was talking to my brother and said, we're going through a bit of issues. He said, you know what, maybe we should give God the driving seat. So we prayed and said, Lord, take the business, do what you need. And it moved. We got out the way. So are you allowing God to conduct your life? Are you putting Him first? The power of evil is not evil, but that we allow the things of Satan in our home. Amen? It's when a culture embraces this stuff is the downfall of a culture. So you might say, what do we do? What do we do in this time? Well, I'm going to read the book of Acts, chapter X, and I'm going to show you what we should be doing as Christian believers. And then we're going to pray for some of you. In the book of Acts 26, verse 18, this is what it says. This is what we are required to do. Not worry about these days and worship these festivals and live outside of God. But in verse 18, it says to open their eyes in order to turn them from darkness to light and from the power of Satan to God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among those who are sanctified by faith in me, as well as casting out demons. We should be doing the work of God. That's what should be consuming our life today. How's your prayer life? Are you following God? Are you honoring God? Are you doing the work of the ministry? You all in full-time ministry. The day you gave your life to Christ, you all in full-time ministry. There's someone in your life that can hear a word of encouragement. There's someone in your life that you can believe for their salvation. We are called to save the lost at all cost. Cast out demons. Overcome sickness. And pull down powers in our city. I'm going to read you a prayer this morning. So if we could all stand. And I'm going to lead you through a prayer to break things off our life. Before I do that, I'm going to do something very special for you. I'm going to sing the song to you, which I've done before. Before I pray, I want to tell you who Jesus is. Jesus is the King of the Jews, the King of Israel, the King of all ages, the King of heaven, the King of glory, the King of kings, the Lord of lords. Do you know Him? Do you really know Him? A prophet before Moses, a prophet after Melchizedek, a champion like Joseph, Joshua, an offering in place of Isaac, a beloved, rejected, exalted son like Joseph. Do you know Him? Do you know Him today? He is our Redeemer. Kinsman. He is our avenger of blood. He is our city of refuge, our performing high priest, our personal prophet, our reigning king. Do you know Him? Do you really know Him today? You and me are the beneficiaries of a love letter. It was written in blood on a cross erected in Judah 2,000 years ago. He was crucified on a cross of wood, yet He made the hill on which it stood. By Him were all things made that were made. Without Him was nothing made that was made. By Him all things are held together. Do you know Him? Do you really know Him today? He blesses the young. He cleanses the lepers. He defends the feeble. He delivers the captives. He forgives the sinners. He franchises the meek. He guards the besieged. He heals the sick. Hallelujah. He provides strength to the weak. He regards the aged. He rewards the diligent. He serves the unfortunate. And He sympathizes and He saves. Do you know Him? I wish I could describe Him to you. He is indescribable. He's incomprehensible. He's irresistible and He's invincible. Do you know Him? The heavens of heavens could not contain him. Man couldn't explain him. The Pharisees couldn't stand him. And learned they could not stop him. Pilate could not find fault with him. The witnesses could not agree against him. Herod couldn't kill him. Death couldn't hold him. The grave couldn't keep him. That's my God. That's my Christ. That's my Savior. That's where I put my faith, in a resurrected Christ. Come on, don't tell me he can't heal you today. Don't tell me he can't turn your situation. Amen. Are we going to put our faith in that man? Halloween is nothing. My Jesus is a healer. Amen. Our beloved Emily is going to come up and sing. But I'm going to lead you through prayer. Let me tell you now, the day I turned my life to Christ, it was never the same. I promise you. It was never the same. Never the same. And I promise you now, when you grab that word of God and you do what it says, your life will be blessed. There's no other way. You can run your own way. You can run from this book. Things won't be blessed until you implement what His word says. So I'm going to lead you through a quick prayer. Say, Heavenly Father, I ask you today, by the Holy Spirit, that you would bring me to the place that you need me to be, at the cross. Anything that has hindered me, I ask by the Spirit of God, and I give you my free will to come into my life and to free me of every form of the demonic. Whatever's hindering my finances, my health, my relationships, my ministry, I cancel it by the blood of Jesus. I declare and decree, no demon in hell can take my life, because my life is for Christ. And so therefore, I cancel every form of witchcraft, every form of the occult, all trauma and abuse. I tell you, Satan, you are defeated today. I am going to rise up and take my dominion that God gave me by faith. I speak into my future and I declare I'm somewhere in the future, and I look a lot better than I look right now. I'm somewhere in the future, and I look a lot better than I look right now. I'm somewhere in the future, and I look much better than I look right now. I'm somewhere. Amen. Just as you stand, quickly, I'm going to pray. You can close your eyes. Father, I come against every form of the occult in this place. I come against all sickness right now, and I take authority over it right now. I come against whatever's hindering your life. I come against the spirit of fear in this place. I come against the spirit of death and the spirit of oppression. Right now, loose them in Jesus' name. Let them go, says the Spirit of God. Let them go. Father, I take authority over every principality that's affecting anyone in this place. You are defeated by the cross of Christ. And right now, I take authority over all forms of oppression that's affecting your growth and spiritual life. I come against every principality right now that's affecting your marriage, your finance, your job, and I break it now in the Spirit. Father, I come against all hurts and wounds by the blood of Christ. I want you to repeat this. I renounce every word of death, every word of jealousy, all anger and rage that has been done behind my back. I let them go. I break those covenants. Those who have hurt me, I let them go this morning. I forgive them this morning. But today, I will not let it affect my life. I let them go. I cancel all witchcraft this morning. I break all blood covenants, all rituals and ceremonies. Anyone who's done evil in my bloodline, I renounce all of it. Under the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. As always, I'm going to pray for some people. And we're going to go into some worship, but I'm going to have the microphone off. If you've come this morning and it's your first time, we welcome you. If you need prayer this morning, I'm going to pray for you. Whatever it is, we don't need to know. I'm going to pray. And so while Emily worships, if you want to go, you can go. If you need prayer, please come to the front. If we can turn the back lights off and the live stream, God bless you. We're going to have a powerful time of prayer. And I'm asking my intercessories if you could keep praying for those who need healing. God bless you.